right, if everybody's ready, we will call the May 12th, 2022, Coffee County Board of Education Work Session to order. Mr. Preston is out of town and will not be able to make it tonight. Ms. Johnson is running a little bit late. She had a conflict, but she will be here shortly. So Dr. Banks, if you wouldn't mind, if you would give our invocation, we'll get going.
Say, good afternoon, everyone. I just wanted to publicize my appreciation to the board members, Dr. Leese, all of you for having me all these years in Coffee County. And I want to say a special thank you to all the stakeholders in this area. It's been very emotional, very, very heartfelt, all the things that you guys have done for us, me and my family. I tell somebody I want to leave out in style. I'm not going to bash anybody. I want to leave out in love. Amen. And when I became principal, first time in my life in 2003 at Broxton Mary Hayes Elementary School, I had somebody tell me, he said, Banks, if you could help them, help them. And I had the same thing told to me in 2011 when I became the principal at the freshman campus. If you could help them, help. 2015, I came up here on the board, and the late Ronnie Johnson told me again, Banks, if you could help them, help. And that's all I ever tried to do with personnel, students, etc., try to help people. People will tell you, say, Banks, he ain't worried about your color. He could help you, he gonna try to help you. That's all I ever tried to do. 21 years in this district. I can't bash a district that helped me pay my mortgage off, buy cars, clothes, food for my family, help me pay child support. I can't bash a district like that. I love you too much. So I leave you with what Paul said in 2 Timothy 4:7. Paul said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Now, Paul did not say, I won the fight, and he didn't say, I lost the fight. He said, I fought a good fight. Amen. And that's how I want to be remembered here in Coffee County. Banks fought a good fight. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this night. Thank you, Father God, for your son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father God, for your Holy Spirit, our comforter, our keeper, our guide, for letting us be alive in the living, the land of the living one more time in this particular day. Father God, we thank you for all the people that make up Coffee County School District, all of our leaders near and afar, everyone striving to make a difference in the life of a child. We thank you, Father God, for every opportunity. We know that every day is a gift. And we must work to the fullest in that particular day because tomorrow is not promised. Yesterday is gone. Today is here and tomorrow will be a mystery until we get there. And I ask, Father God, that we continue to embody the concept of love. We know that love will cover a multitude of sins. And I know, Father God, that in this life, nobody is perfect. We're imperfect people trying to get right with you, Father God. And I ask, Father God, that you intercede for us tonight. Let us be on one accord. Bless our superintendent, our board members, all certified and classified staff in this district. Let us continue to work together for the good of those who love the Lord. And we have a purpose in Jesus Christ. And I ask this prayer in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Banks.
Yes, sir. Ms. Johnson.
Dr. Banks, I'm going to go off script for just a second since you brought it up. But you were here when I got here in some sort of leadership capacity the entire time I've been on this board, and I appreciate the job you've done. You know, you've done an excellent job representing not only James Banks, but also the Coffee County educational system. I don't have a bad word to say about you or the job you've done, and I'm going to miss you.
Yes, sir.
Now, if you're not going to be sitting in that seat any longer, I wish you would at least sign up, come get this free coffee and these free mugs. I am going to miss your invocations.
Yes.
How are you, Ms. Johnson?
Fine.
All right. We're ready.
All right.
All right, so, we had a chance to look at the agenda.
Make a motion, we approve the agenda.
Motion, Mr. Showers. Second by Mr. Wade, all in favor? Dr. Lees.
All right, thank you, Mr. Watt. I'd like to welcome everybody here tonight. We've got visitors and school representatives, so welcome. And at this time, we're going to go ahead and have our school update. And we have Westside Elementary here, and Ms. Showers and her team here to give us a presentation.
Good evening, and thank you for having me and my team. I'd like to thank Dr. Lees and the board for having us here and actually having an opportunity to share a few things at Westside. We promise not to keep it too lengthy, 10 minutes or less, promise. But I would like for my team to stand up and introduce yourselves. I'm Wendy Showers, principal at Westside.
I'm Amy Hughes, I'm assistant principal at Westside.
Stand up, ladies.
I'm Lauren Shirley, I teach third grade ELA at Westside.
And I'm Jenna McDonald, and I teach third grade math at Westside.
Thank you. And there is a reason they are here, because there is something they're going to share with you in a little bit. As you can see on the PowerPoint, it says at Westside, it's all about the climb. So that's been our theme this year. Last year was Rise Up, we liked it, and we didn't want to get rid of it, so we kept thinking we're going to keep climbing. So why do we do that? If you think about climbing, it's an upward, gradual progress. That's what climb is. It's upward, gradual progress. That means to never give up and to reach your goals. And it's overcoming hardships and having hope. That's what it's all about. So this slide, it actually comes from the lyrics from a song, and you'll hear it in just a minute, but it says, it's not about how fast we get there. It's not about what's waiting on the other side. It's about being strong, about pushing on. It's the climb. So you see the hashtag Keep Climbing Westside. That's us. We are climbing with hope, even though we've been dealt, you know, some hardships with the pandemic. We are still moving. Maybe baby steps, but we're climbing. Sometimes we're on the mountain though. Then the next one is our demographics. I'm not going to read that to you. You can read. It's basically the same 3-year trend you've been seeing with at Westside. Our points of pride, again, not going to read those to you because you will see that in the video. So I want to condense my part to make sure that you get to see the video and hear from some other folks. But our saying at Westside is be the best you can be. Be the best you can be. And just keep working hard. Now this part, I do want to share with you because, as we've talked about, we've had some hardships, but we are continuing to climb. And just to give some perspective to where we have been in Coffee County schools and all over the United States and the world with the COVID pandemic, if you look second grade, first grade, kindergarten, pre-K, those kids have never had a normal school year, ever, because of COVID. So you see these second graders, there they are, second and below, have never been in school where they haven't seen masks and all that kind of stuff. And that will impact grades 3 through 5 because they were learning to read, and by 3 through 5 they're reading to learn. So we've done a lot of things at Westside to try to close that gap and close it quickly. I also want to know, just personally, my child is graduating from Coffee High, honor graduate, 12th grader. If you look, the last time my son had a normal school year was when he was in 9th grade. It puts perspective on where we're at and what we've done and the reason we continue to climb and keep moving in the right direction and hit those goals and the targets. And I'm telling you, we've hit a lot of goals despite COVID. So Ms. Hughes is going to share with you some of the things we have accomplished at Westside before we share the video.
Hello, I've got a question for you. How do you become a better reader? By reading. It's just that simple. The only way to become a better reader is to read. So we really are about motivating our students to read independently. We go above and beyond. We want our students to be motivated and excited. This is our ringmaster, Ms. Mackenzie Jones, our media specialist. She's really tired today. She has been in charge of two Wildcat carnivals for K-2 and 3-5 the past 2 days. But what students do is they're challenged to read books on their own Lexile level, and they know how many points they have to have. So it's not a competition against other students. If I take the time to read and take the test, I can earn this adventure. And I really want to point out to you, fourth and fifth graders, the older they get, the less motivated they are to read. I think they have other things on their mind. I don't know if you've ever noticed that about fourth and fifth graders. But at the beginning, at winter time, we only had 15 fourth graders that earned the reward party, and we had 0 fifth graders. And if you'll notice that our carnival, that went to 38 fourth graders and 57 fifth graders. So I'm going to show you what I did to make that change. So I decided I would look at the weekly AR reading reports for all fourth and fifth grade homerooms at Westside. So I'd look at each student. If Johnny had taken 10 tests according to that week's report, and this week's report still showed 10, well, you know, I'm pretty good with simple math. He didn't read at all. And so I might have a little conference with Johnny and offer to him to let him spend his free time in my office. He could read and hang out. And it was a great motivator, though, because then I never had to talk to little Johnny again because he started reading. So I really enjoyed doing that, and I would highlight the children who did a lot of reading. But I think, you know, when children know you care enough to really push and stay on top and motivate, they rise up to those expectations. So we love to celebrate our children. This little fella in the left, he's showing our library cards. Every child in our school has a library card, and it has their own personal Lexile range on it, so they know what books to choose from. And he has a reading log. Every child has a log where they write down their book and their score. He loved it, and he's just one of those success stories. He gained 400 points in his Lexile level.
Second grader.
A little second grader. So. But we thought he would be a great student to show the log and the card. And then we even have the mobile Wildcat den that goes around. So next. The state has a Lexile framework. They give you a range of where Lexile should be per grade level. And they also set a target for CCRPI. So for example, in third grade, when they take the Georgia Milestones, they can score between 520 and 820 and still get a plus for being an on-grade level reader, but CCRPI only gives us credit if they hit 670 or above. So we know that, and we strive. Our goal is for them to hit that goal. So in the middle, I'm not going to read that to you, but you can see the percentage of our students in each grade level who actually met the state target goal. We're really proud of that. And then on the far side, you see average growth from fall to winter. You see second grade averaged 278.3 Lexile points growth throughout the year. That's over 2 years worth of growth. So just so proud of our students, and like to celebrate their accomplishments in reading. And then we have one more slide. We also celebrate math fact fluency. You want to be a fluent reader, you also need to be fluent with your math facts. We love reflex math. Jenna, raise your hand. Third grade math teacher came to me and said, Ms. Hughes, we need reflex math. Now the county has adopted it. It's a great program to build fluency. She actually designed a tracking form that the students use to keep up with their progress. But they have to master both operations in order to be successful. And if you look at those percentages, like third grade, 60% of our third graders right now have mastered multiplication and division with fluency. We celebrate them, and we call them math masters. I call out their names on the intercom. We love our children. We love to celebrate their growth. All right. And now we want to show you some other things that have happened this year at Westside.
I can almost see it. That dream I'm dreaming, but there's a voice inside my head saying, you'll never reach it. Every step I'm taking, every move I make feels lost with no direction. My faith is shaking, but I gotta keep trying. Gotta keep my head held high. There's always gonna be another mountain. I'm always gonna wanna make it through. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes I'm gonna have to lose. Ain't about how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side.
Them tell you about it.
I do want to say that Jen and I are both very proud to work at Westside. The showers and the teams both give us many opportunities to grow as educators, and I don't think we can pick a better place to work. In honor of the month of love and friendship and National Random Act of Kindness Day, which is celebrated on February 17th each year, our school begins Kindness Challenge. Each day our goal was to perform an act of kindness towards others. We begin every morning by reading a challenge and asking our kids to try to complete it before the end of the day. Some of those acts included writing notes to teachers, leaving bookmarks with kind notes for others to find, making new friends, cleaning up our school grounds, showering our first responders with love and appreciation, and a healthcare appreciation day, which included our pediatric offices, urgent care facilities, and our staff at CRMC.
We also encourage parents and community members to accept the kindness challenge and challenge others to get involved as well. We created the hashtag BeCoffeeKind as a way to showcase this kindness on social media. And we also created and sold t-shirts with our hashtag on it as another way to help spread our message. Acts of kindness are not only special for the receiver, but also feel good as the doer. At this time, we would like to share Westside's kindness video. We would like to give a special thanks to Jay Hennessy, Coffee High Senior, for the hard work he put into helping our vision come to life.
Hi, my name is Wendy Jowers. I'm the principal of Westside Elementary School. I just would like to share with you that in the last couple of weeks, starting February 1st, running through February 17th, we have been implementing random acts of kindness.
For me personally, First Responder Day was very important. I come from a family of first responders.
We reached out to the local responders of Coffee County Fire Department, Police Department, Sheriff's Department, and our local EMS. Our idea was for them to come out and let us thank them. We had cards and signs and letters and pictures from our kids. The kids really enjoyed it because they were able to speak into the radio, hear the sirens.
Having them come and see our kids and interact with them was a very special experience.
You never know what someone's going through, especially children. A lot of them don't talk about things and they don't share things with adults, but they'll share things with other kids. So we wanted to make a point for our kids to reach out to somebody that they never talked to, that they never played with.
Kids need to learn to play with other kids that they're already playing with.
It's important for us to remind them that it's healthy and it's good for them to branch outside of their 1 to 2 or 3 friend circle.
As long as we can promote this kindness between kids, that the friendships are just going to grow, and everybody needs a friend.
The kids drawing thank you cards means a lot to the school.
Perhaps the biggest one that got me was the thank you notes to the teachers. You had some that wrote to these teachers that they hadn't had for 3-4 years, but that stood out to them. And also, not only from a kid's standpoint, like knowing that they got that gratitude, but also watching the teachers read them. I'd be lying if I said I didn't read every single one.
I received a bunch of them from kids that I taught my first year and my second year and my third year, but it made me cry when I got them all. This was very special to us. We had this idea. We wanted to help kids and families in our community, and our kids have blown us away with the amount of canned foods that they brought in.
The kids have been really excited about helping the community with this project of giving food to those in need.
I think that's going to teach the kids that some children are not as fortunate as them, and that we can easily help out by providing them with canned goods.
On behalf of all Westside Wildcats, I want to challenge you to take up our mission to show kindness. In a world where you can be anything, be kind.
Be kind.
Be kind.
Be kind.
Be kind.
Be kind.
I hope we didn't go over our 10-minute time. But this has been such an honor to be able to share all, well, part of the great things that happen at Westside Elementary. We're going to just close the way we started. It's not about how fast we get there. It's not about what's waiting on the other side. It's about being strong, about pushing on. Ladies,
it's the climb.
Keep going. Great job.
Great job, ladies. Appreciate y'all's work that went into that. That was really informative. All right. If there's no questions, then we'll move on with the minutes from the April 2022 meeting. Were there any questions or additions or amendments we need to make to those minutes? Please, the board, we'll place that on the consent agenda for the regular meeting. Financial report. We have financial reports prepared by Ms. Yong, and we have 4 different documents that have been presented to the board. And then after we talk through the financials, then we'll have a budget hearing and talk about the budget. Ms. Yong, you want to describe these documents for us?
Yes, sir. The first document is our financials as of April 30th, 2022. We have ended the month of April with a fund equity balance of $27,383,992.66. First document. The comparison, it compares the past 3 fiscal years. You can see as of April where we're at. From the month of March, we dropped about $150,000 there. Compared to the previous years, it was slight. last year we increased a little bit, but the previous year we decreased about that same amount, but it's not been very much changed through the months of May, March and April there. The report here is a detailed report of our financials that goes through the month of April. The first portion is our revenues for our general fund. For the month of April, our total revenues, we ended with $57,341,566.67. For our expenditures, for the different functions of the school system, the total expenditures as of March are $52,723,129.81. As of April. The month of April. So you can see as of the month of April, the balance was $27,383,992.66 that we ended April with. Our SLOSS report. The revenue was $693,602.90 as of April. So for the fiscal year 22, the revenue each month has been up compared to as of 2021 pretty well. See any questions or?
What happens if, and I know we got a long way to go, but we talk about the way the waste clause is tracking and the maximum we set if we go over that. How does that work? Do you just cut it off at that point?
It'll stop. And that's a conversation we're going to need to have. I had just done a rough estimate. I was estimating we would end about 2 months in advance. And I talked with Bill Camp, who's with Morgan Keegan, the bonding company. And he said he had looked at it. He thought we would finish a quarter ahead.
Yeah, I mean, easily 3 months.
And so it will stop when we reach 35 million. And so what we need to start discussing is when we put it on the ballot to renew, because we could set it up so that as soon as it's approved by the voters, when it stops, it would immediately restart with the new SLOSS, so you wouldn't miss a month. So that is a conversation we're gonna need to have at some point. And the last time we took it to the voters, it was like 2 years in advance.
We took it at least one conversation in advance.
That's right. So I was originally thinking 2024 we would go back to the voters. And we just need to look at it. Let's see.
Is that a November vote?
I'm not sure.
It's got to be. So if you go a year ahead, what's happening to the next year?
And I know that either the city or the county is going to do a SLOSS next year for sure. And the conversations I had with them was that I was pretty sure at that point we wouldn't be going back to them next year, so they will go ahead with theirs. I'm not sure what month when that's going before the voters, but it is something we need to start planning.
But you've got to remember what I'm saying is if you go to 2024 and everything worked out, that's great. Then you're put yourself in the hole.
Yeah.
If we're going to do it like we did last time, you almost need to put it on in 2024.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
we'll
take a
pay to vote. Yeah. We'll just have to get a list of when those elections will be, 23, 24. Start looking at it in the middle of that. So, good question. Anything else? Three, 24 dates. budget hearing number two. So we're going to call the order a budget hearing, and we've been working on the budget since our last work session, and we're coming back to the board with a document that presents a balanced budget and ready to be advertised in the paper. Ms. Yaw, you want to describe what we have right here?
So this is our tentative budget. At the last board meeting, we had our first hearing. We presented the revenues in detail with our local and our state and our federal. So our estimated revenues for FY23 are estimated at $74,462,469. For the expenditures, broken down by the different categories. And in the budget here, just want to kind of go over what we kind of included in this budget. The TRS for FY23 is at 19.98%, which is the employer portion. There's $2,000 increase in the certified salary schedule. There's a 3% increase in the classified salary schedules. And bus drivers, a $17 an hour for the time over their initial 3 hours of work. That's what is included in this budget, for a total expenditure of $74,462,469. The estimated, we're estimating at this point, we'll have to do some more closing procedures, but at this point, roughly the $24 million is where we're, see us ending this fiscal year. Okay. The next columns is our federal money. That's an estimate of what we'd be receiving there. And then the next is our SPLOST, and then our debt service account, which is our bond payments that we have to make. So we'd like to advertise this for 2 weeks in the newspaper and also on our website, and then come back to the board on, I've got May 27th at 9 a.m. to adopt.
Any questions? The staffing is pretty much what we talked about back at the retreat in February. All that stayed the same, and so pretty much everything we talked about in February in regards to staffing and the budget and such has remained the same. So not a lot of additional, much additional at all. We have talked with Buddy and been talking about those things.
Yes, sir. Do it.
As far as the $17 an hour, we've done that.
Whatever you end up coming up with.
What we talked about was some training, and then through training, there would be possibility of some compensation for some training if they go through to get credentialed and additional skills.
Job a mechanic and not driving a bus.
Yes, sir.
Staying on the bus is a whole lot. So
yes, sir.
Well, we have something that's for the other folks that do.
Yes, sir. Well, it's something we can certainly look at. Like I said, I just talked with Buddy about it yesterday, and he was going to come up with some way to be able to do it, and it makes sense.
Well, the hope was, hopefully with $17, we wouldn't maybe have quite as much of a shortage, maybe. We'll have to see.
Yes, sir.
How that's going to work out.
But if it does not.
Probably problem we got with available buses, if we got one break down, they can't even fix it, start with.
I talked with him about hiring an additional mechanic.
Yeah.
You know, if we need another mechanic, let's get another mechanic.
Well,
he's trying to hire one right now.
If this doesn't take some of that off of it, then that's what we'll have to see about doing something like that.
He's working on hiring. He's got an opening right now.
I do.
Yes, sir.
Just something, you know, keep in mind.
Yes, sir. Well, that everybody is getting a 3% increase, right, across the board, and then as far as bus drivers and mechanics, when they drive a bus, they get $17 an hour when they drive that bus. So we'll study it. We got a couple more weeks before we adopt the budget, so. All right.
Make that point. Go back through what we increased, 3%, but go back through all that real quick.
Okay. The TRS for fiscal year 23 is now going to be at 19.98% from 19.81% in 22. The certified salary schedule will have a $2,000 increase for each step. There's a 3% increase for classified on their salary schedule. And then bus drivers will be at $17 an hour for the time that's over their initial 3 hours that they drive the bus, which is 3 hours is the initial state paid hours.
And that's simply my point. I'm talking about budget meetings. We do have several things in here that we went up on, increased on salary-wise and different things, and we still got a balanced budget for this year.
Yes, sir. Yeah, every employee in the school district will be seeing an increase in their salary next year with this budget of at least 3%. That would be a fair statement.
Yes, sir.
All right. Any other questions? And we'll work on your answers to those questions before we have that meeting on the 27th. Yes, sir. All right. If there's nothing else, then is there any public comments? This is a budget hearing, so if there was anybody from the public who wanted to make a comment, they certainly could. All right. Well, we will close out this budget hearing then, and move forward, and we will reconvene on the 27th with the board to discuss the budget and hopefully approve it then. So, all righty. School nutrition. We have our school nutrition department that is asking for approval, and I'm recommending approval of their FY23 bid renewals. Ms. Lewis, do you want to present this information to the board and describe it?
This is our bid renewals. We're just asking you to renew the bid that you approved last year for milk products, paper and chemical products, and food products. And those are all with Williams Institutional Foods. And they've agreed, and the documents are attached. You'll see they've agreed to the bid renewal, and it also has the two counties that piggyback off our bid, their renewal paperwork is in this for you to review as well. But it's just basically a renewal that we're agreeing to continue purchasing from our same vendor that we have been.
All right. Any questions about that? I did receive an email from the Superintendents Association, and I forwarded to Dawn a couple weeks ago that school districts across the state are having problems that finding vendors to actually bid on their food bids. And so it's becoming a real problem across the state. And I was telling Mr. Lott as we were discussing the agenda today that we're really blessed to have Williams Food right here in our backyard. And That really is a blessing for us to have that. So
I know Savannah Chatham is, they can't find a food vendor, and there's about 28 counties that can't find a milk vendor right now in the state of Georgia. So we are very blessed that we have not had that problem.
Thank you. All right. please, the board will place that on the consent agenda. Surplus property. We have some items from the technology department. Do you have an attachment there?
No, sir. The items will are in the middle school now, the boards and projectors. We have a summer renewal project coming up, and we would like to go ahead and declare those surplus so we can dispose of on site rather than having to move around. For the boards, they're big and clunky, and we want the recycler to pick those up from the back of the school rather than stage them somewhere else. And then the projectors, since that's coming out, and any associated equipment, like brackets, and they look like this right here. So mountain plates, brackets, projectors, we want to go ahead and surplus those. We typically would sell those on gov deals. And so we wanted to get out ahead of the game. That project is slated to start after school lets out. And so go ahead and surplus that so we can do what we need to when the time comes.
All right. So this would be a request to surplus the Coffee Middle School equipment that's going to be removed this summer.
Yes, sir. The active boards like this and the projectors like that.
All right.
They'll be on gov deals.
That's the plan. The boards, I think they're just going to recycle, but the projectors and mounts. That's what we've been doing with when we surplus the boards. They're so old, we recycle them.
You're going to keep those?
The boards? Recycle.
And put them in another school? Or?
No, we have a recycler that picks them up and recycles the e-waste.
There's no interest in those things. We're not going to maybe a smaller school system or something.
We could try it. We take those out and decommission them and send them to the recycling, e-waste recycling. You know, one of the problems with these is the pins. You can't get them anymore, and they require a pin. They don't charge. You can't fix them. They're old too.
It's antiquated technology. A lot of places either go into, like we've done with the short throw projectors and the solid board. Touchscreen TVs. And so these boards were built, there's actually hardware inside of them that reads that pin.
There's a grid inside of there that can be damaged.
But now they've got actual, when the projection is up there, the pin is read through the...
Yeah, there's a little eyeball that reads the pin tip.
You know, killing me, we're going to have to go back to Chalmers.
All right. Well, good deal. Any other questions? Okie Finoki RESA contract. This is our contract with the RESA, continued services. And this would continue services, $54,364 for the next year. The next item on the agenda is the student handbook. We've got the student handbook. It has been presented and we've discussed it. Really no major changes. You've been presented with a list of what those changes are. It's really a changing of terminology and verbiage in the handbook. Dr. Banks has done a great job over the years of working with the principals to edit and to update the handbook. And so we feel like it's a good product that serves our schools well. And at this point, we're asking the board to approve the handbook. I do want to ask for one change before we approve it. If you open up the handbook on page, and you can open that up, Logan, and go to page 25, I think it is. And on page 25, I do want to add, there's a statement that clarifies middle school cell phone use. And if you see at the top of page 25, there's a statement that says cell phones, electronic devices. At Coffee Middle School, there is no use of cell phones, supervised or otherwise, using a cell phone in any capacity at the middle school during the hours of 7:45 to 3:30 p.m. is a level 2 infraction. I know I talked to Mr. Jowers with you about this the other day, and I checked with the principal, and that, in fact, is what they do. So that achieved what we had talked about. There's some Fulton County, just their board approved banning cell phones in kindergarten through eighth grade. Essentially, that's what we do. That's what that statement does. They can't have their cell phones out. They don't need to have them out. And so I thought what we may want to do is add that statement to page, to the elementary portion of the handbook too. Just take that statement and put it at the top of the elementary portion so that it's clear that we don't want the elementary kids getting those cell phones out and having all that too. So that would please the board. Just ask to make that one change. And that way we wouldn't have cell phones out kindergarten through eighth grade. They shouldn't have. So, all right. If it pleases the board, we would ask for approval of the handbook, get the regular meeting and the consent agenda with that one minor change to what was presented.
What is the policy in high school?
The high school, I think they have the ability, if the teacher wants them to be able to use it, because they use them in some of their classes, then it says that they can use them if the teacher...
Use it, video, fight, stuff.
Well, that is a problem. Not looked at that far for the high school. Scrolling through it right now. Dr. Banks, you recall what the high school 9 through 12 cell phone policy?
Normally they have usage if they have a curriculum as far as the syllabus in certain classes, certain subjects. But normally, I think it needs to be stricter than that because kids use those phones all the time. Just to be honest with you. I don't know how to really channel that and make it fair or without.
I just wonder what kind of, if we had any kind of policy to regulate it. We don't have no kind of policy.
You can confiscate it for up to 10 days.
Yeah.
We still have that in effect at grades 9 through 12. But as far as carrying it out, it's not.
Having it out in class, just on the internet, they still do it. We don't have nothing done.
Not really.
Teacher take it up if you
can. Oh, yeah.
Teacher can take it up, but you run into a lot of confrontation over that phone.
Looking forward in the handbook here. We're high school.
Problem's going to be at the high school is there are so many things that they actually do use it for. Certain teachers actually do encourage on it. How you're going to word that, it's going to be a difficult part of that.
Yeah, I wasn't planning.
That's going to be a problem.
I was thinking.
Teacher approved?
Yeah, that's.
Yes, well, I just don't know how you word it. They do. They use them to email and this and that. I mean, a lot of stuff they actually do on their phones at high school level. How you differentiate how you differentiate between that and that is going to be where the problem is.
That's why I was real comfortable with the elementary and the middle school because that's.
Page one has a section here. I've highlighted.
That's it there.
Was that covered?
That's the reference in the confiscation in 10 days.
Yeah. Is that on page one?
It is. No.
When you go by
and the general school system information.
Well, it's the direction of administration.
Yeah.
There's your answer.
So that's an address. Yeah. I knew it was an address somewhere. District acknowledges that students have cell phones. However, students' cell phones and electronic devices should remain secured appropriately unless directed to be used by a teacher or his or her supervision. Cell phone devices are subject to confiscation. So, yeah. If they're told to put them up, they should put them up.
doesn't say high school specifically, so does that statement conflict with the middle school statement?
Well, no, because the middle school statement governs the middle school, so.
No, they do interfere with our network connectivity at times, depending on if virtual private networks are set up for hotspots, so that's some of the issues we've seen, and we've had to manage that to turn off certain sections of Wi-Fi. So,
yeah.
From a technology standpoint, it does pose somewhat of a security and connectivity issue.
Well, we can table it and come back next month with, or we just move forward with the recommendation. I was real comfortable addressing the middle school and
I think you got it right there. It says cell phone devices are subject to come by the direction of administration.
All right. Discuss this with Mr. Preston, no. The cell phone stuff.
We talked about it a couple weeks ago, and we talked about kind of what Fulton did. Just banning them, but I'm pretty sure their ban was in K-8. It wasn't 9-12, because you get those kids who are juniors and seniors who are doing dual enrollment, and they have, as you said, sometimes really legitimate reasons to have.
Well, we'll just play that little call meeting when he's here.
All right.
No rush, is it?
No, as long as we get it done by the end of May.
Yeah, well, we have a meeting that
That's right, May, that's can. Right. We can have it published in June or July.
Okay, if you're going to do something in high school, though, you're going to have to get a lot of input on how to do that.
Yeah.
I don't think that's going to be a quick fix there.
Yeah.
I don't want to
there is a fix.
I'm just saying, I don't want to be comfortable going and doing the elementary part of it. And if they want to work on this over the next year, trying to figure out how to do it, and maybe that's something you should do for next year.
Yeah, I hadn't talked to the high school folks about it.
I just don't think you get that done by next meeting. That's going to take some careful
work
in there.
Yeah. Well, I don't want to create a problem where it is a problem.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I'd like to look at it, but I think that's something that's going to take a lot of input from high school teachers. Yeah. You're not going to get that done by the time this needs to be done.
All right. Well, we'll table it. We'll come back. We'll take that off the consent agenda and come back at the work session in May. Finish it. All righty, executive session. We'll move to an executive session to discuss personnel, employment or disciplinary action or evaluation of public school employees.
So moved.
Got a motion. Second by Ms. Johnson. All in favor? We're in executive session. All right, we need a motion to exit executive session.
Second.
Motion second, all in favor. All right, executive session and the May 12th, 2022 work session is adjourned.